Well, good morning. He is risen. He's risen indeed. It is just a glorious day for us to celebrate the risen Savior. I'm so glad that you're here this morning. Many of you have received personal invitations from friends or family to join us, and I'm glad you have. Some of you came early enough to get some breakfast, and it was good. And we had good fellowship in there. And then the rest of you joined us in time to see a kid on the stage do this. Amen. We're going to celebrate the resurrection. You're going to do it right. Amen. That's awesome. Well, I have the privilege this morning of taking the Word of God and encouraging us from it concerning the great truths of the gospel. And to do that, I'm going to ask you to join me in the book of Romans, the first chapter. Romans chapter 1 is where we'll find our Easter text this morning. So take your copy of God's Word, and if you didn't bring one, maybe you could look on your phone at the scriptures, or look on with a friend who's sitting next to you who has the Word of God, and we'll read that and trust the Word of God has the power to really penetrate our hearts. And my prayer is that every one of us will walk away today blessed by the gospel message. So if you're a long-time believer and you've been in church a long time, I hope the resurrection message this morning encourages you. If you're kind of new to faith or beginning your walk with Jesus and you're trying to figure this thing out, I hope this morning that you're encouraged by the Word of God. And maybe you're here, you're just visiting, and you're not quite sure what it means that Jesus is out of the grave. I hope that today you come to an understanding of what that means. What the choir has been singing about, what we've been singing about, the testimony we heard from Sarah. Thank you, Sarah, for that testimony, wherever you are. What encouragement that was. The truth that was shared with the party hat guy. All of these things have been about the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the message of Jesus. The story of Christ's death and resurrection make up what we call the gospel. The word gospel simply means good news. Now, we've become pretty skeptical of the news and that word news and the concept of news today. Looking online at your news feed, in about 5 to 10 words, the media often tries to capture your attention and cause you to click on that story. We've learned over the last year about this thing called fake news, right? Where something happened and someone is trying to generate a response or create a perception that fits a narrative that they desire because they have an agenda. They want us to move in a certain direction. Well, I'm glad to tell you today that the gospel is not fake news. The gospel is life-changing. The gospel, it's good news. It's good in every way. And it's good for every one of us. And that's why we celebrate it today. Now, the good news is this. Salvation is found in Christ alone. All right? That's the good news. So why don't you look at your neighbor and say, I've got good news for you today. Just say that right now. I've got good news for you today. And I say, well, what is that? Tell them, the gospel, the salvation is found in Jesus alone. Say that to your neighbor. Salvation is found in Jesus alone. See, y'all helping me share the good news today. I like that. That's good. Salvation is found in Christ alone. That's the message of Easter. That's what the choir has been singing about. That's what we've sung about today. And that's why we're here praising the name of Jesus. That's why we desire that everyone would follow the person, Jesus Christ. In the book of Romans that we're going to look at this morning, the gospel or the story that salvation is found in Christ alone is made very plain for all of us. Let's read about the introduction in this book of Romans in the first chapter where Paul determines to share this good news. In chapter 1, verse 13 through verse 17, it reads this. Now, I would not have you ignorant, brethren, that oftentimes I propose to come to you, but was let hitherto, or I wasn't able to, I was held up, that I might have some fruit among you also, even as among other Gentiles. I am a debtor both to the Greeks and to the barbarians, both to the wise and to the unwise. So as much as is in me, I am ready to preach the gospel to you that are at Rome also. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Father, we're thankful today that Paul had a desire to preach to the people at Rome the good news of Jesus Christ. He knew there was nothing that would shape their life or give them hope beyond the gospel, the good news. We're thankful today that salvation is in Christ alone, and we pray that that message would resonate in our hearts and would transform us, that we would believe it and respond to it and live according to it. So, Lord, bless in all of our hearts today that we might have ears to hear and eyes to see these truths and how it will change our life. We pray in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen and amen. Well, the message of the gospel that salvation comes in Christ alone is more than a story of just one day we call Easter. In fact, the story that salvation is found in Christ alone is the message of the entire Bible. Now, the story of the Bible is just this. If I can kind of shrink all 66 books into one paragraph, that there is an eternal God who created everything that is. He created man, placed him in a garden, but man sinned. And as the story of the Bible goes, man sinned and sinned, and people groups sinned, and whole nations sinned and sinned and sinned. And the result of all of man's choice of sin was death. And we see death and destruction and decay because of man's choice to sin. Rebellion against God. Until one day, a baby was born, and that baby's name was Jesus. Jesus was fully God and fully man, and he came and lived a perfect life, and he died on a cross. And he didn't die to pay for his sin because he didn't commit any sin. Even at his trial, they said, there's no fault found with this one. Couldn't charge him with anything. But 3 days later, after he was died and buried, 3 days later, he arose back to life, and Jesus demonstrated the power to save. And the Bible says when people trust in Jesus, they are radically changed, and that they can look forward to the eternal blessings that come in having a relationship with Jesus Christ. Friends, that's the story of the Bible. But that story that's found in the Bible is encapsulated in very poignant verses. So it's the story of all 66 books, but it's found, that good news that Jesus saves is found in just single verses in the Bible. One that you might be familiar with is John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him, that is Jesus, should not perish, but have everlasting life. John 3:16. Isn't that a wonderful verse? So simple, we can understand that God sent his Son Jesus so that when people believe on him, they have everlasting life. They don't have to die in their sin. I like this one in Mark chapter 10, verse 45. It's kind of the theme verse of the whole Gospel of Mark, which talks about Jesus being a servant. And that verse says this, for even the Son of Man, or Jesus, came not to be ministered unto, but he came to minister, to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus didn't pay for his own sins, but he paid for our sins, didn't he? And he gave his life, and he came for that purpose. Salvation is found in Christ alone. Or 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15, where Paul was writing to the young man Timothy, and he said this, "This," speaking about the gospel, "is a faithful saying. It's worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came in the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners, whom I'm chief. And that's the gospel. That's the story of the, that's the good news in one verse. One preacher I read on that passage, he paraphrased the first part of that verse where it says, "It's a faithful saying, it's worthy of all acceptation." He paraphrased it, that verse, this way. "Hey, knucklehead, place your confidence right here in the gospel," right? It's worthy of all of us to accept this reality, that Christ came to this world to save sinners. Well, Paul, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that resurrection chapter, where he's arguing for the validity of the resurrection, he starts that chapter with a summary of that good message, the gospel. When he says this, "I delivered unto you," speaking about the Corinthians, "I delivered unto you first of all that which also I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scripture, and that he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures." Paul said, I'm passing on the good news. I received the good news. I want you to hear the good news. And that is that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, or just like the scriptures said he would. And that he was buried and he rose again 3 days. Now, one of the themes of all of these verses, and certainly a part of the gospel that we need to understand, is that Christ died for our sin. All right, for us to really understand how good the good news is, we have to understand really our sinful condition. If we don't come to an agreement this morning on the topic of sin, we're never going to accept the premise that the good news is really good. There are two phrases that I think help us really understand or capture the essence of what it means to sin. Those two phrases are this: missing the mark and crossing the line. All right? Missing the mark and crossing the line. Crossing the line is just literally God drew a line. And all of us have trespassed or crossed the line that he drew. But when the Bible says that we are dead in our trespasses and sins, Ephesians 2:1, it's saying that we crossed God's command, where God says, this is what you should do and this is what you shouldn't do. And all of us saw that command and we made a choice. God, we don't care what you've said. And we trespassed. We crossed the line. That's sin. What does it mean to miss the mark? Well, what is the mark? Well, Jesus said, are you ready for this? Here's the mark. The mark is this: absolute perfection. That's the mark. Absolute perfection. Matthew chapter 5, verse 45, Jesus said, be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, are you perfect? Be honest, you're in church, okay? Obviously, none of us are perfect. None of us are perfect. We've all missed the mark. We have all sinned. And that's what Romans says. Romans says all of us have sinned and come short of that mark, the mark, the glory of God, or his perfection. You might very well be a good person. I'm not necessarily here saying that you're not a good person, but I am affirming the reality we've all sinned. Heaven is not for good people. Heaven is for forgiven people. And one sin is enough to keep us out of heaven. James chapter 2, verse 10 says that whoever shall keep the whole law yet stumble in one point is guilty of the entire law. If you've ever been to a jeweler's and you're going to look at rings or jewelry or precious stones, you know what that jeweler does the second you walk in and you begin to look. He unfolds this black velvet cloth. And whatever jewelry you're looking at, he places it on the black cloth. cloth. And do you know why they do that? They do that to display the beauty of the object they're presenting to you. They want you to see it as beautiful as it is. Well, God has sought to show us just how good the good news is by first telling us how bad or black our sin is. When we realize our complete inability to do anything to alleviate our miserable condition called sin, we will come to celebrate the good news that God sent His one and only Son to die for us. One of those other passages that just is the gospel in just a few verses, which is so helpful, is Romans chapter 5, verse 6, 7, and 8. It says, "For when we were without strength," in other words, we had no ability to hit the mark. It says, "In that time, Christ died for the ungodly. Scarcely for a righteous man will one die, and yet peradventure, perhaps for a good man, some would even dare to die. But watch this. God commendeth," or demonstrated and showed, "His love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." The magnitude of Christ's love is accentuated by the reality of the blackness of our sin, where we have rebelled against God and we've said no to God's commands and we have not attained His measure of perfection. And yet, God loved us in our sin. The message of the gospel is made beautiful when we understand our sin. Well, this message of the gospel, the good news that salvation is through Jesus alone, calls for four responses found in our text in Romans chapter 1. We're sinners, yet Christ loved us and died for us, and He's risen again today and offers forgiveness of sins. What's the response called for in the text? Well, the first response we see is the very response Paul is taking. The gospel calls us to passionately proclaim the gospel. Notice in our text, in verse number 14, it says, "I am a debtor to both the Greeks and the barbarians." He was saying, as a debtor, I am obligated to both the intellectually elite, the Greeks, and to the ignorant, the barbarians, people who could speak the fancy language and people who just babble. Right? That's the contrast. To the wise and to the foolish. In other words, I have a debt. I'm obligated to share this message or good news to everyone. It's like a city being conquered by a new king, and that king entrusts his herald or messenger to proclaim his victory within the city and offer all those residents of the city his pardon. And the herald, therefore, owes it to all the citizens in that city to tell them urgently. Right? It's necessary. They need to hear there's a pardon available by the conquering king. And if the herald fails, he will incur the wrath of the king, because the people will not accept the pardon because they hadn't heard about it. So Paul says, I am that herald, and I am indebted. I have an obligation on me. I've heard the good news. I have to come share it. I have to proclaim it. In verse number 15, he says, I am ready. I am ready. One translation of the Bible in that passage says, I'm so eager. I can't wait. I'm so eager to preach this gospel to you. And in fact, though he's delayed in his travel, he takes the next like 11 chapters in his letter that he's writing to these people, called the book of Romans, to share this message. That's how eager he was. It's not like, well, I'll get around to proclaiming this gospel. No, he's excited. He's eager. He's passionately proclaiming the gospel. And then verse 16, he says, I'm not ashamed. He's not talking about the feeling of shame, but he's talking about becoming the object of shame. He will not be proven wrong in this news that salvation is found in Christ alone. He knows that that news is not fake news. That news is real. Do the investigation. Salvation comes from no one else. He will not be publicly disgraced. He won't lose his anchor job, right? When it becomes revealed that he's sharing a false story. He knows this. He knows he's experienced salvation in Christ. Paul certainly felt that and realized there would be rejection from people. The towns he would go into, they didn't like it. They mocked it. They rejected him. But there was no shame in proclaiming Jesus because he knew Jesus was powerful enough to save. Now, have you ever noticed that the thing that we're most passionate about, we also talk about? I mean, the things that our hearts are given to, you just spend some time with some people and ask them a few questions, and they'll talk about their grandkids. And they'll pull out their wallet, and man, the photos just kind of unfold. And oh, let me tell you about all my grandkids and how wonderful they are. Why? Because grandma and grandpa is passionate about their grandkids. Or if somebody's really passionate about the St. Louis Blues, or not the Cardinals these days, but the Blues, and they're going to talk about this playoff game and that goal scored, and they're going to talk about it because they're passionate about those things. Well, I wonder, Paul is passionate about the gospel, and he's ready to talk about the gospel. I wonder this, are you that passionate about the gospel, Christian? Are you that passionate about the gospel? Are you ready at a moment's notice to talk about the risen Savior? Because the gospel that salvation is in Christ alone must be our message. More than simply at Easter time. I mean, it's wonderful. I was at breakfast this morning. I was talking, hey, he's risen. Pastor, Jesus is alive. Happy Easter. It's Resurrection Sunday. And boy, we celebrate. Yes, that's good news today. But I wonder, is that our message day after day and year after year? And are we eager and ready to share it on other days as well? I would encourage you. I think it's important to be a part of a church where the message that Jesus is Christ, that Christ alone saves, that message is proclaimed at the church, in the message, in the counseling office, in our personal interaction, in our care group time, that we are sharing with one another this same message. What does the death and burial and resurrection say about sin? Are we eager and passionate to relay that good news then? Romans chapter 10, Paul asks a series of questions. This is kind of at the tail end of having him shared the gospel message, and he's relaying to us the need to articulate the gospel. So let the weight of Paul's words weigh on you today as you think about your eagerness to share. He says, or asks this, how shall they call on him in whom they haven't believed? And how shall they believe on him of whom they've not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher or without a herald, without someone to share it? Friends, this is God's plan for how the gospel is going to be spread. It needs to be proclaimed. How sinners are going to be reached. And how the name of Jesus is going to be made famous among the nations. So listen or lean into those questions again. How will they hear without a preacher? And how will they believe if they've never heard? Dear friends, we need to experience the weight of the call for all Christians to passionately preach the gospel message to all people. I wonder this morning at this Easter service, if you're here and the weight of God's call is pressing on your life, and you would say this morning, Father, I surrender to proclaim that message. I will give my life to preach that message, whether it's to the Greeks or the barbarians, if there's a particular people group or a location you want me to go, here am I, send me. And I am eager, and I am ready, and I will not be ashamed of that because it's powerful enough to save. This morning, the gospel calls us to passionately proclaim it. Secondly, it calls us to make Christ-like progress. Look at verse 13. It says, I anticipate that there would be fruit among you. I would have some fruit among you. In other words, as I share the gospel, it's going to produce something. there's going to be evidence that the gospel is taking root and things are changing. Fruit is occurring because the gospel is going forward. In verse 16, it says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God." Focus on that next word. Unto salvation. The idea of unto salvation pictures that salvation here as a destination. Not just something we've accomplished in our life in the past, but something we're anticipating coming in full. In verse number 17, we have that phrase, from faith to faith. Again, some translations have that as faith from beginning to end, or faith from first to last. And it pictures the path that the gospel places us on as a journey. A journey we're on. The gospel says that not simply is your guilt gone, and you no longer have to face the wrath of God. Verse number 18 talks about God's wrath. But the good news of the gospel is that you will be making progress in your present fight against sin. Romans chapter 1 through 4 deals with the past act of salvation. That Christians call that our justification, or we're declared to be in a right standing with God. And that's a wonderful truth of salvation. But Romans 5 through 8, in the middle of chapter 8, deals with salvation's present aspect. We call that sanctification. That's the journey or the progress that we are to make. Salvation includes our ability to say no to sin. It includes our ability to live a life more and more like Christ. The gospel calls us to make Christ-like progress. I recently have been counseling a couple whose marriage was riddled with sin and conflict. The husband and wife had become cold toward each other, and they were wondering why they had ever gotten married in the first place. We immediately, in our counseling sessions, began studying gospel truths. As I'm hearing about their life, I'm pointing them that Christ alone saves, and he ultimately gives us the ability to live in marriage in a right way. And one day, the husband said, "You know, I don't think I've ever trusted in Christ the way you've talked about." And that day, before the session ended, he bowed his head, and he did. He prayed and declared his faith to be in Jesus Christ alone for salvation. And from that day forward, we really started making progress in their life and marriage. Fast forward 8 to 9 sessions, about 2 to 3 months that we've been going since the time of his salvation, and they are growing in their marriage. It is awesome to see the transformation that is taking place. Now, I'm not saying that this couple or their marriage is perfect. Now, this past week they came in, and the husband had sinned against the wife again in a way he had previously sinned, and it was discouraging to her. And I was really curious, well, how did you handle that? And as I listened to them tell me about how they handled sin, he said, "Well, I got under conviction, and I confessed it." And his wife said, "And I was really mad at him and angry, and I didn't I wasn't ready to forgive him." She said, "About a day later, the Lord God was impressing upon me how much I've sinned against God." She said, "I went to him and I told him, 'I forgive you.'" I was like, "Thank you, Lord." I said, "Do you guys know what we call that?" And they looked at me and like failure. I was like, "No, that's progress." 8, 9 weeks ago, you didn't handle conflict that way. But you had a problem in your marriage. There was a sin in your marriage. And because of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the power of Christ in your life, you handled sin and conflict in your marriage before you ever got back into my office. That's progress. And the gospel enables all of us to be making progress day by day, step by step, becoming more like Jesus Christ until one day, what the end of Romans chapter 8 points out, is we will be glorified. We'll be perfectly like the image of Jesus Christ. And I'm looking forward to that perfect and complete and the unto salvation that the gospel points us to. Let me ask you today, where are you this Easter? Let me set up the contrast. Where are you this Easter compared to where you were in your spiritual journey last Easter? That's a good barometer. I mean, we often look at our finances in a year, right? What have our investments done? What is our debt load, right? We look at it in that year timeline. Well, look at your spiritual progress. Are you closer to Jesus by the way you live and the way you think because of the good news of the gospel? Or are you kind of like not embracing the gospel and you're less like Jesus Christ in the way you interact with people today, in the way you think today, in the way you behave today? Because the gospel calls us to make spiritual, Christ-like progress. If your spiritual life has been stalled because of sin, I want you to remember today where your living, risen Savior is. Because later in the Gospel of Romans, chapter 8 and verse 34, Paul is addressing the issue of, we've sinned, what do we do? And he asks this question, who is he that condemns? And there are those that condemn. And Satan stands in the throne room and he condemns and says, hey, look at Kevin. He's still a sinner. And Paul answers, it is Christ that died. Yea, rather, I'm going to bank it on this. He is risen again. And he's at the right hand of God. And he is making intercession for us. So if you're here and you took that spiritual, like, one-year snapshot, here's where I was last Easter and here's where I am today, and I'm not anymore like Christ, I want to encourage you today that Jesus is alive and he is in heaven rooting for you, interceding for you, praying for you, sending his Spirit to you. Friends, because Jesus is alive, you can become more like him right now, today. And the gospel calls us to make that spiritual progress. Thirdly, the gospel calls us to acknowledge its power. Very clearly, I'm not ashamed, verse 16 of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes. The resurrection screams power. Jesus was dead, and he came back to life. He said, I'm stronger than you, death. I'm getting out of this grave. You have no hold on me. It couldn't stop King Jesus. And if you are in Christ, get this, good news, gospel right here, sin and death cannot stop you either. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 14, and if Christ is not risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain. Like, if Christ didn't get out of the grave, everything I'm saying has no merit. It's empty. It's powerless. It's powerless. You have no hope of conquering sin in your life. You have no hope of meaning in life if Jesus isn't alive. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 19, just a few verses later. If in this life only, that's the stress there. In other words, there's no resurrection. We have hope in Christ. If it's just here and now, and we just have the example of Christ to know how to kind of be a good person. He says this, we of all men, of all people in all religions, we are most miserable. You should have pity on us if Jesus is dead. But 1 Corinthians 15 tells us he's not dead. Amen. Jesus is alive, and there's power for life today. We acknowledge that power. 1 Corinthians 15, just a few verses. But now is Christ risen from the dead, and he's become the firstfruits of them that slept. In other words, everybody who died, just like Jesus rose, you're going to rise if you're in Christ. By man, Adam, came death. By man, capital M, Jesus, came the resurrection from the dead. For as in Adam, all of us died spiritually, even so Christ, all of us, can be made alive. There's power in Christ's resurrection. And it's We're called, the good news of Christ is we're called to acknowledge the power over death and the power over sin, the power to change. Paul experienced a radical change in his life. The story of Paul is told in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse number 12. He says, I thank Christ Jesus our Lord. He's enabled me. He counted me faithful. He put me into the ministry. And he tells his story about who he once was. This was Paul's story. I was a blasphemer, a persecutor, and injurious, but I obtained mercy. In other words, the gospel had an impact on my life. The grace of our Lord was exceeding abundant with faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. Exceeding abundant. Again, when you contrast the blackness of Paul's sin, it elevates the glory of Christ's salvation. Three words demonstrate Paul's condition. I was a blasphemer. Paul said this, before I found and embraced the gospel of Jesus, I was somebody who oppressed and slandered God. I defied God and his purpose, and he did it in a religious guise. I was a blasphemer. He said, I was a persecutor. Paul was somebody who attacked Christians who believed the gospel. And he did it ruthlessly. You know, the text of Scripture says he went from house to house looking for Christians, and he would take men and women, anybody who professed Christ, and he would haul them to jail and prosecute them and put them to death. That was his ambition. That was his drive. That's who he was. He was injurious, or a violent man. He persecuted Christians. We might call him today a terrorist. That was Paul. Yet he met the risen Savior one day and his whole life changed. Why? Because there's power in the gospel. There's power in the gospel. What's your response to this power? It should be the same as Paul. Paul said after telling his story in 1 Timothy chapter 1, he just kind of erupted in a hymn of praise. Now unto the King, and listen how he lifts up King Jesus, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory both now and forever. Amen. He is acknowledging the power of the gospel. We could go from disciple to disciple and show the power that God had in their life to change their life. From what they were as doubters and fearful to becoming bold and giving their lives to proclaim and spread the message that Jesus alone saves. We can look at examples of people in the New Testament church, like in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And it says that these people were the kind of life that they lived. They were sexually immoral, idolaters, adulterers, practicers of homosexuality. They were thieves. They were greedy. They were drunkards. They were revilers. They swindled people. And he says this, such were some of you. But that's not who you are anymore. You know why? The power of the gospel changed you. He says, but you've been sanctified and you've been justified by the name or in the name or with the authority of Jesus Christ the Lord. Men and women who have been changed by the power of the gospel are sitting in the pews today. There are people among us today who could stand up and give testimony, just as we heard this morning of somebody who had a lot of doubt and had no joy and lived life in depression, but the gospel changed her and she now has a life of purpose. There's men here who could say, I once lived for my next drunken binge, but by God's grace and because of the power of the gospel, I've been sober. And they can tell you how many years they've been sober because their lives are now filled with something greater. There are husbands and wives who have found the power to forgive each other after multiple acts of adultery only because the gospel is powerful enough to do that. There are single individuals here who lived according to the fear of man and they didn't want to attempt anything, but now they're attempting hard things in their life because Christ is alive and because the work of grace in their life and because the love of God has filled that person so that it's changed their perspective on what matters most, and that's pleasing God, not pleasing people. That is due only to the power of the gospel. And Paul says, I'm not ashamed to proclaim it because it has power. It changes people. The salvation is for everyone. It's for the Jew first and also to the Greek. It changes anybody. It changes everybody. There's no one here. I didn't ask anybody to leave today. I didn't say, you need to step out because the message I'm going to say is not for you. It's for the Jew. It's for the Gentile. It's for the Greek. It's for the barbarian. It's for the wise. It's for the foolish. Doesn't matter who you are today. Doesn't matter what is in your background. It doesn't matter what's in your past. It doesn't matter what sin you've committed. Salvation is offered for you. It can be your good news. It's powerful enough to save you and change you completely. So we're called to proclaim it. We're called to make Christ-like progress in our life. We're called to acknowledge its power. But the gospel, lastly this morning, calls us to personally place our faith in order to possess salvation. Verse number 16, it says, it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To everyone that believeth. The Christian apologist Francis Schaeffer said, the circle of salvation is large, but it's also very small. The circle is as big as the world, but it includes only those who believe. Each individual has a choice of either accepting or rejecting the gospel. Now remember, the gospel or the good news is all about what Jesus did. He died for our sins. Jesus rose again, and we are helpless to save ourselves because we all fall short, right? Our phrases were miss the mark and cross the line, and that's our condition. So we have to believe in Jesus. We have to trust in his perfection, in his death and resurrection, so that we might possess salvation. I heard about a wonderful offer the other day. It was an offer that was too good to refuse. It was an offer that was going to make my life better. It was the offer of a free breakfast sandwich from Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A on Thursday morning was giving away free breakfast sandwiches. In different months, it's different sandwiches. But I heard about that offer, and then that chicken biscuit from Chick-fil-A. Can we just say, like life-changing? Well, maybe not life-changing, but definitely morning-changing, right? It's going to be a better morning with a Chick-fil-A chicken biscuit. And I heard that they were giving it away, but I doubted. I was a little skeptical. I'm not sure anybody gives away their food. You know what I did? I called them on the phone. Hey, I heard that you're giving away chicken biscuits this morning. Is that true? And they said, yes, sir. Anybody in your car comes through the drive-thru will get a free chicken biscuit. I don't have to order anything. No, you don't have to order. You just come, tell Tommy you want, and we'll, you know, for everybody in your car, you'll get a free chicken biscuit. Well, hot dog! That's awesome. And I hung up the phone. I said, kids, come on. And they're wiping the sleep out of their eyes. We're going to Chick-fil-A. We're going to get us a chicken biscuit. Now, I believe the person on the phone. I did. I called the right number. They answered. This Chick-fil-A on Mexico Road. Mid-Rivers. I believed them. But I didn't possess the chicken biscuit. I didn't have it in my hand, and it wasn't in my belly. You know what I had to do? I had to believe what they said and get in the car and drive to their store. And I had to speak into that box and say, I've heard you're giving away a chicken biscuit. And there are six of us here, and we'd like six of your chicken biscuits. I don't know about you, but I've never gone through a drive-thru and asked for something free before. That's not the way it works. Everybody else makes you pay. They wouldn't take anything. If I would have offered them my debit card or some cash, they would have said, "No, sir. Your order comes to you today free. It's a free gift." But I had to believe them enough to ask them for it and get in my car and go through that drive-thru and reach out my hand, and they put in my hand a bag filled with chicken biscuits that I was able to pass around to my family. I believed, and my faith led me to action. It's one thing for you today to say, I understand Jesus died. And the Bible says there were a lot of people who saw him rise up, and so based on their testimony, okay, there are people who witnessed him alive. So I guess based on their testimony, I can believe that Jesus died and he rose again. But there are people who believe what we're saying this morning, but they still do not possess salvation for themselves because their belief hasn't turned into a response that said, "I am going to get this free offer. Lord, I want salvation. You died not just for other people's sins, but I must have forgiveness. I need it. It's not just going to fill my belly for breakfast one day, but it's going to change my life for all eternity." And that's what God is offering to you through Jesus. And because he's alive today, it is a free offer to you if you would just say, "I need that, and I want that. And Jesus, you paid for it, and I'll receive it." Do you possess salvation? I'm not asking, do you believe that Jesus died and rose again? I'm asking, do you possess salvation? Are you on that journey? Is your life being changed? If you don't possess it today, believe not just that Jesus died and rose again, but believe to the point where you say, "If I don't get that, my life is ruined. And I can't pay for it, but I will receive it."